I am Noriko Bullthorne, and this is Uncut News. According to the ERC, a lot of people out here on social media are pretty racist. In fact, they said 87.2% of the complaints received are regarding incidents on social media, more specifically Facebook, with a total of 89 complaints out of 102. However, the commission noted that their capacity to productively investigate those complaints is limited by factors including the prevalent use of fake profiles to make racially insensitive posts or comments. However, real profiles also present a challenge at times as well. As a result of those limitations, the commission has begun a persons of interest campaign with the public's help, actually aided them in tracking down many of the profiles. And thus far, only 8 incidents garnered legal action, with one resulting in a conviction. The government is turning to India to assist in making the pipe dream of a profitable sugar industry possible. As a result of the Agriculture Minister's recent meeting with the Indian High Commissioner, 2 technical officers from India will be coming to assist with the reopening and diversification process. They are now looking into value-added products and uses for the currently shuttered factories. Minister of Housing and Water, Colin Crowe, has sent home the entire board of the Central Housing and Planning Authority, including the chairman, and a new board will be installed shortly. According to reports, the government doesn't feel that the board is committed to the implementation of the PPP's policies and programs for the housing sector. Triple G Spot sells big people bedroom toys. Show yourself some love. Call them on telephone number 649-3679 or message them on Facebook at Triple G Spot and get yourself a rubber friend. Another Friday, another weed bust in Berbice. Yesterday morning, the police force conducted a drug eradication exercise at Gatroy and Develt villages in the Berbice River and unearthed a literal ton of green gold. Have you noticed all the busts seem to be happening around these 2 villages? It's as if it's the weed capital of the nation. Anyway, according to police, 10 fields containing 211,220 plants of Selassie's best were discovered. A nursery with approximately 200,000 seedlings was also found. They also found a shotgun in the bushes nearby. The police estimated the total weight at over, get this, 337 metric tons, with an estimated value of several billion dollars. And as always, the police burned the whole operation to the ground. Thus far, there have been no arrests. On Thursday, 18-year-old Courtney Johnson of Lot 33, East Rumvelt, Georgetown, was arraigned for assault for allegedly knocking out 2 of his stepfather's teeth with a piece of wood. On the day in question, Johnson's stepfather came home to find him with a girl. Not wanting anyone to get pokey in his house, but he, reasonably enough, the stepfather asked both of them to leave his home and proceeded outside. Apparently enraged by the lack of pokey, Johnson followed him outside, picked up a piece of wood, and knocked the man's teeth out. Lord. The court also heard that on August 28th, the teen allegedly chopped his stepdad on the hand, probably again over pokey, but that matter is still being investigated. Nevertheless, he was released on $45,000 bail and has another court date on October 16th. Johnson wasn't the only teenage delinquent to face the courts. Yesterday, 19-year-old accused thief and amateur escape artist Joshua Haynes of East Rumvelt was arraigned for escaping from lawful custody. He denied the charge, which alleged that on August 30, 2020, at Rumvelt Police Station, while being in custody pending investigations into a simple larceny allegation against him, he broke free of a pair of handcuffs and escaped. Haynes was released on $50,000 bail. Conditions attached to bail require him to lodge his passport with the court and report every Monday to the Rumvelt Police Station. He is due for another court appearance later this month. Thus far, ExxonMobil has flared over 10 billion cubic feet of natural gas at the Liza Destiny FPSO vessel. It claims the issue persists due to defective equipment currently undergoing repairs in Germany. Head of the APA, Dr. Vincent Adams, had noted that loopholes exist in the Laser One permit, which have been exploited by ExxonMobil to flare, despite doing considerable damage to the environment. Now, keep in mind that despite the repeated excuses from the company here, in September of 2019, Exxon was able to address flaring issues at one of its plants in Scotland. According to the BBC, as complaints continued to grow by the hundreds, ExxonMobil made the announcement that it would spend the equivalent of US$186 million on work to mitigate the flaring, which included fitting flaring tips and other technology to the plant in Scotland. So, everyone, keep the pressure on Exxon, or they will continue to get away with such bad behavior. You've always dreamed of owning your own car, but it seems like your foot is destined to be on the tar. Change your destiny. Bring your $800,000 savings down to BM Soltanto Sales at Lot 9 Crawl Street, Georgetown. Tell them Noriko sent you to find out about their loan option, or call them on telephone number 231-8451. BM Soltanto Sales, it's your turn to try. Now, let's take a look at news in the region and around the world. The ruling Jamaica Labour Party won 49 of the 63 seats in Thursday's parliamentary election, meaning a landslide victory for Prime Minister Andrew Holness. In fact, Holness called for the early vote last month in what analysts saw as a bid to capitalize on people's satisfaction with his economic agenda and early response to the virus pandemic. But he has faced criticism amid a surge of cases as restrictions are lifted. Face masks and temperature checks were compulsory in polling stations. The campaign was dominated by discussions over the economy, how to fight crime, and the pandemic. The result was one of the largest margins of victory in decades, but also one of the lowest voter turnouts at 37%. In 2016, turnout was over 48%. Prime Minister of Barbados, Mia Motley, has claimed that women make better leaders than men because they run their country, quote, like a household. She appeared on Good Morning Britain today with the former Prime Minister of Denmark, Helle Thorning-Schmidt, and the former Prime Minister of Australia, Julia Gillard, to debate whether women make better leaders. She claimed that females are, quote, more caring than males and consider more the impact their decisions will have on people's feelings, meaning it's easier to change people's behavior. This comes after a study comparing countries of a similar size with comparable populations, which showed that at the start of the pandemic, women reacted faster, locked their countries down sooner, and had less deaths overall than those run by their male counterparts. And frankly, I agree with them. Look at how she's leading her country as opposed to the flaming dumpster fire you have here. Look at countries that are actually taking control of the pandemic. Germany and New Zealand, what do they have in common? Exactly. If you vex, drink Marvex. 7 years after former National Security Agency contractor Edward Snowden blew the whistle on the mass surveillance of Americans' phone records, an appeals court has found the program was unlawful and that the US intelligence leaders who publicly defended it were not telling the truth. In a ruling handed down on Wednesday, the US Court of Appeals said the warrantless telephone dragnet that secretly collected millions of Americans' telephone records violated the Foreign Intelligence Surveillance Act and may well have been unconstitutional. Snowden fled to Russia in the aftermath of the 2013 disclosures and still faces US espionage charges. Nonetheless, he said on Twitter that the ruling was a vindication of his decision to go public with the evidence of the NSA's domestic eavesdropping operation. There is a legit way you could earn some extra cash to supplement your existing hustle that does not involve two people or 21,500. Sell top-up. You could become a top-up vendor quick and easy by linking Cellular Plus. Call them on telephone number 685-3109 for more info. And now for our weird news story of the day. You know how I love those stories about how businesses have adjusted to the pandemic. Well, this one is for the ladies. And I guess some of you guys out there, you know, if you're into that type of stuff. Anyway, a sushi restaurant in central Japan is trying to boost its sluggish demand during the pandemic by sending shirtless bodybuilders to deliver food to its customers. The service, dubbed Delivery Macho, was established by 41-year-old Imazushi chef Masanori Sugiura, who is also a competition bodybuilder. Sugiura has recruited his friends, who worked at fitness gyms, to work as sushi delivery staff, as they were out of work during the pandemic. The only condition is that customers need to order a minimum of 7,000 yen, which equals $66, to have the Macho Man delivery. The promotion was an instant hit. His restaurant now receives up to 10 orders a day, with monthly earnings from the service of about 1.5 million yen. Maybe fish shops in town could consider using Venezuelan women's to deliver. Maybe. Oh well. Moving on to our uncut news, viewers poll question of the day. Every day we pose a question about current events in Guyana, the region, the diaspora, and how you feel it relates to us. So, you give your responses in the comments, and we'll read the best ones in the following episode. Yesterday's question was, should we give those young men the job to clean up the cemetery? Tao Seti said, yes, the government should give them the job as it provides some form of employment and hence reduce potential crime. Nicholas Basdio said, they deserve that contract indeed, because from the looks of it, they look fed up with the conditions they are seeing the place in, and with that pride, I believe they will do a good job, especially if they're paid well. And finally, Yehuda the King said, the Guyana government should pay the young men to clean up the cemetery, and at this point, they should be attempting to design that cemetery like in other developed countries and pay them well. Sounds like we all agree. Give the boys the job. Good stuff. So tonight I leave you with this question. The PPP really seems to be set on fulfilling their campaign promise of reopening the sugar estates. Do you believe that it is even possible, or should we just sell off the industry and call it a day? I want to hear some good answers, people, not the recycled ones we always hear our politicians repeat. So, think about that question and tell us in the comments below. If your response is good, we just might feature it in our next episode. That's all the time we have for tonight. Until next time, I'm Noriko Bullford saying, have a great weekend, and as always, don't drink and drive, or you'll end up on Monday's episode the hard way. Ha ha! Hey Uncut News viewers, thanks for watching. You can subscribe by clicking on this button over here, or click over there for more news. You can also drop a comment to let me know if you've made it to the end of the video. Goodbye for now!